the Mapping Our Privacy, the Use and Misuse of Location Data panel. I'm going to briefly introduce our panelists and myself, and then we're going to kick it off. So I'll start with Judge Smith on my right. He's magistrate judge in the Southern District of Texas, and he issued basically the first opinion that challenged the government's hybrid theory for prospective cell site tracking in 2005. Susan Freewald, who is our host at this great panel, professor at USF Law School, and who also argued in the Third Circuit case, along with Kevin Bankston, which was the other cell site tracking case that has come up for appeal. And Stephanie PELL, she is a former prosecutor at the DOJ. She was also a counsel to the House Judiciary Committee and is now a consultant and thinker about electronic surveillance. The reason I'm here, I'm a technology editor at the Wall Street Journal, and I have been writing about online privacy for 2.5 years now. I was telling Jim Dempsey that I started off really writing about commercial data collectors like Google and Facebook, and slowly but surely got sucked into the world of government surveillance, and so here I am. And I think I've written, I wrote a front page story about Judge Smith in October, in full disclosure. So we are going to start with Judge Smith, who's going to tell us how he came to this issue of location tracking.
All right. Thank you very much, Julia. For those of you who don't know, she's also known as the Princess of Privacy. Oh. So and, I'm going to pay for that, but just so you know. All right. Now, is this on? Okay. Now, I really had no exposure at all to this issue until after I became a judge back in 2004. I then learned at that time that this issue had really been around for some time. In fact, I recently came across an instructional video on counter-surveillance that was issued by the British many years ago. Rumor has it that this video was recently uncovered by WikiLeaks. I can't vouch for that, but I've got it here on a DVD, and if you'll indulge me a couple of minutes, I'd like to show it to you because it helps give some valuable perspective on our topic today. Before I ask them to start to play the clip, I want you to tell you to pay special attention to Mr. Nesbitt, who is case number 3. All right, play the clip, please.
In this picture, there are 40 people. None of them can be seen. In this film, we hope to show you how not to be seen. This is Mr. E.R. Bradshaw of Napier Court, Black Lion Road, Southeast 5. He cannot be seen. Now, I'm going to ask him to stand up. Mr. Bradshaw, will you stand up, please? This demonstrates the value of not being seen. In this picture, we cannot see Mrs. B.J. Smegma of 13 The Crescent, Belmont. Mrs. Smegma, will you stand up, please? This is Mr. Nesbitt of Harlow, Newtown. Mr. Nesbitt, would you stand up, please? Mr. Nesbitt has learnt the first lesson of not being seen, not to stand up. However, he has chosen a very obvious piece of cover. Mr. E.V. Lambert of Holmley, the Burroughs Oswestry, has presented us with a poser. We do not know which bush he is behind, but we can soon find out. The middle one. Mr. Ken Andrews of Leighton Road, Slough, has concealed himself extremely well. He could be almost anywhere. He could be behind the wall, inside the water barrel, beneath a pile of leaves, up in the tree, squatting down behind the car, concealed in a hollow, or crouched behind any one of 100 bushes. However, we happen to know he's in the water barrel.
Thank you.
Mr. and Mrs. Watson of Ivy Cottage, Warbleston Road, Hull, chose a very cunning way of not being seen. When we called at their house, we found they had gone away on 2 weeks' holiday. They had not left any forwarding address, and they had bolted and barred the house to prevent us getting in. However, a neighbour told us where they were. And here is the neighbour who told us where they were. Nobody likes a melody. And this is where he lived. And this is where Lord Langdon lived, who refused to speak to us. And so did the gentleman who lived here, and here, and of course here. And Manchester, and the US Midlands, Spain, China!
Now, I cited this video in a footnote to my latest sell-side opinion for several reasons. Partly it was to see how many people actually read footnotes and opinions. And by the way, your Professor Freewald passed the test. But also because it illustrates, I think, a sobering point. If the government wants to find you, it can and will find you, even with generalized cell site data. The government can easily combine that with other information, such as Facebook page, employer's location, what have you, to figure out exactly where you are at any given time. And this is true even if, like the unfortunate Mr. Nesbitt in the video, you don't want to be seen and refuse to stand up when you're asked to do so. Okay. Now, I said I took the bench back in 2004, no background at all in criminal law. In fact, I'd never heard of a pen register or trap and trace device until I was asked to sign one an order for one on my first day of criminal duty. The application asked for something called cell site information. And I was reluctant to sign what I didn't understand, so I pulled out my copy of the U.S. Code and encountered ECPA for the very first time. It was a frustrating experience. The terminology is unfamiliar, the organization was not intuitive, and again, it didn't seem, the syntax was such that even if you spoke English as a first language, it was probably not very helpful. The case notes accompanying the statute weren't helpful. I cited only a handful of lower court decisions that were not particularly relevant to the issues or the questions that I had. No appellate court had ever addressed the issue. I asked my colleagues on the bench and found they were just as puzzled as I was. I mean, I tried to look at sample orders from other courts. I couldn't get them because they were sealed. I met several times with AUSAs in our district who basically argued that their request should be granted because other judges had granted those requests. So I was still unsatisfied, so I plunged into the legislative history. Read every committee report and law review article I could find, contacted law professors who had written about ECPA, as well as a former congressional staffer who helped draft the law, and these people, many of these people are here today. I met with our local U.S. Marshals Service, got a tour of their electronic surveillance shop. I kind of felt like James Bond, you know, at the beginning of those movies, where he's given a tour of the newest in electronic surveillance toys. I called service providers to find out what their perspective was, to see what it was like to having to deal with these orders that they get from judges. And then I spent several months drafting a memo and basically setting out my conclusions, which were admittedly tentative, but with my analysis done, then I submitted that memo to the U.S. Attorney's office. And I said, Here's what I think. Here's my position. Tell me where I'm wrong. And at that point, I believe they, as far as I understand, they transmitted that memo to DOJ in Washington. Then a few months later, I get back their detailed rebuttal, which was basically advocating the position that's come to be known as the hybrid theory. And that's the first time I ever encountered that. Still unpersuaded, then I wrote my first opinion on cell site information in October 2005. So, and now I'm here today.
And you've continued to write. Yours is the case that's in Fifth Circuit.
Right. The most recent case is now on appeal to the Fifth Circuit. And the case that I wrote in 2010, it was appealed to the district judge in our district, who basically affirmed it in a mercifully brief one-page opinion. Judge Hughes is famous for being succinct. And so anyway, they have appealed that decision now to the Fifth Circuit. I think a briefing is ongoing there. As far as I know, that's the only appellate court that is currently considering that issue.
Professor Freewald?
Well, I was going to spend a little time just laying out the law of cell site location tracking. We were going to do that in the primer, and we didn't get to it. So why don't I do that a little bit, and then I definitely think we'll have some time for conversation amongst us, including I know we want to hear more from Judge Smith about some of his other thoughts on some of the problems and needs for reform in this area. So I think I need a techie person to give me the clicker. Okay, so this is just a general overview of cell site location tracking and location data acquisition by law enforcement. And let's start by just asking, how is it that law enforcement acquires information about our physical movements through our cell site location information? And the first way is through our cell site location information. And there's one big dichotomy that you need to understand, and that is, going back to what we were talking about this morning, the difference between information that's collected about forward-generated information, or real-time information, or prospective information, and information that's collected about past location data that's considered collected out of storage and is considered records of information. So cell location information is either forward-looking or past information, stored information. Also, we know now better, we've been reading about it in the news, law enforcement can get location information about us by putting GPS trackers on our cars. And then this last category is something I won't talk about, but it has been a lot of interest here in California, and that's learning about us through getting information from our cell phones when we are arrested. Okay, so what is cell site location data? I think you probably have an intuitive sense of what it is. Everybody who uses a cell phone, which is everybody, understands that when you're on the phone, your phone is communicating with the radio tower that is then connecting to the cell phone network and processing your call. And the question is, how much information is collected by the service provider, and what does that information reveal about where you are in physical space? And the answer is, we don't know. I should sort of move over there, actually. Then I can stop turning around. Let me see if I can do that. Can I ask you to move? There you go. Yeah, that would be better. Thank you. Okay, great. Okay, the question is, in some sense, how detailed is the information, and that is related to how often is it collected. So the information could be collected as often as when you start a call, when you end a call, all along the call, information about which tower your cell phone is communicating with. So, the question then is, how much is stored? And again, that's something that we don't know because the providers don't tell us. And these questions of how much information is in the records is very much at issue in the litigation. And that is related then, how much information it is relates to how closely the information indicates where you are in space. Because in other words, if you make a call and information is generated just at the beginning of the call, then that's one data point for the entire call. But if information is generated every few seconds that you're on the call, then that's gonna give much more of a rich picture of where you are throughout the whole time you're on the call. We know that information's generated even when you're not making a call, it'd be nice to know exactly how much is stored by the providers, but we don't know that. In addition, another very important question is how close is the cell tower to you physically, so that we know when they know the tower, how much do they know about where you are, and that is also something that varies a lot by provider, it varies over time. Our understanding is that the towers are becoming smaller and smaller, more powerful, and so there's becoming a more direct connection between the tower information and your physical location. So, what is this information? It's kind of an existential question, but in litigation, it's very much an issue. What is the government asking for? What are they getting? And it relates to the question of how much is this information impinging on a privacy interest? In the case I'm going to tell you about shortly, which is Judge Smith's decision that's being appealed in the Fifth Circuit that I'm working on along with EFF and ACLU and CDT and now EPIC, one big question is, how precise is this location data? And that's related to what do the records themselves have? Okay, so I'm just going to very briefly go over the rules so that you know and so that then we can talk more about it from a policy perspective. But again, as I said earlier, the rules are divided according to whether the information is gathered in a forward-looking manner or in a backward-looking manner as records. For forward-looking data, there are several choices as to what standard to require before law enforcement can access the data. One would be the super warrant that we talked about this morning under Title III or the Wiretap Act with these very high burger-type standards. Another rule would be to use just a probable cause warrant, and the appeal of that is that that's the rule that you would use if you were regulating a tracking device. Another standard you could use is the D order. See why we had our primer, so I could just go through this quickly. Specific and articulable facts. And then the last standard to use would be the pen register standard, which as you heard is a very minimal standard and available without any independent review. In a case from 2005, that went the opposite way of Judge Smith and Judge Orenstein, actually I think decided by Judge Gorenstein, the court said that they would use a 2703D order plus a pen register order. So this is the hybrid order. And some of us said that this was 0 plus 0 and it still equaled 0 and it shouldn't have been enough, but several judges have been persuaded that for forward-looking data, these two standards together, satisfying these two standards is enough to allow you to acquire forward-looking data, whereas either one alone would not be enough. And the reason that the pen register standard alone is not enough is because of a provision in the 1994 law, CALEA, says you can't use a pen register for location data, as Jim Dempsey was just mentioning. It's unclear whether this is the right answer. I certainly think it's not. Judge Smith wrote a very excellent opinion where he said it was not the right answer. And that instead, first of all, it's not clear at all that we should even understand cell site location data tracking to be covered by ECPA, that we should instead think of these devices as tracking devices when they're used to collect location data, and that we should then see these as covered by the Fourth Amendment and get a warrant. And I will just say that in their defense, the decisions that have used the hybrid order for location data forward-looking have noted that the data has been fairly limited. And so they've said, we're not talking about triangulation data, for example, which is data from multiple towers that allow you to be even more precise in your pinpointing of someone's location. So to sum up, forward-looking, many cases have rejected the hybrid order and required a warrant. Many have required the hybrid order, and those that have allowed the hybrid order have said, but maybe it would be different if we were talking about very precise data. Historical data. Now we get into this big question of the third-party rule and whether stored data is less protected because it's in the records of the service provider. So the big case that Jim was talking about at some length, and that Judge Smith mentioned, is the Third Circuit case. It's the first appellate case, and it's just so striking that it's taken this long for there to be appellate cases. As you can see from the earlier slide, Congress was thinking about location data back in 1994, hasn't figured out what to do about it. And that's one reason that ECPA needs to be reformed in this area. But this case asked the question of what is the right standard for access to location data, and there was. As is typical in these cases, there's no defendant because law enforcement sought access to historical cell site location data for a target. The target was not identified and I think has still not been identified to this day. Interestingly, because law enforcement used only the D order and didn't get a warrant, law enforcement did not establish probable cause, and there was some question as to whether the target was even suspected of criminal activity. Again, under the D order, you don't have to establish probable cause, just relevance to a law enforcement investigation. And my understanding from the facts below is that the target was someone whose phone was used by someone who was suspected of criminal activity. So that's one of the things that we civil libertarians worry about, is that law enforcement's going to use a broader standard to acquire information about people who are tangentially related to criminal activity. And again, in this case, a very unclear record about exactly how precise the cell site location data was, and law enforcement arguing vehemently that it was not very precise data, that it couldn't put the person at interest in a very small geographical space, but rather, you know, maybe just could tell you very vaguely where the person was. So the issue was, first of all, was the tracking device covered by ECPA, and therefore covered by the D order standard, which, as you remember from this morning, does not provide notice to the target for records or a statutory suppression remedy. And the next issue was, if it is covered by a D order, must the judge grant access by law enforcement if the D order standard is met, or must the judge require a warrant, or may the judge choose to compel disclosure or choose to impose a warrant? And so the first bullet point is what the government argued, that as long as the D order requirement was met, access should be granted. The next, the middle bullet point is what I argued, you should have a warrant in all cases. And the last is what the civil libertarian groups, EFF, ACLU, and CDT, led by Kevin Bankston, argued, and I underlined it because that is what prevailed. And so that is, the Third Circuit issued a decision saying, from now on, it's up to the magistrate judges to decide whether to require a warrant or not. I wrote a law review article in the wake of this decision saying, I think they should have gone with what I said, which was that it would have been better had the Third Circuit gone with the middle argument and just required a warrant in all cases, that that's what the law should require, and that that would have been better guidance. And they would have gone this way if the Third Circuit had agreed that constitutionally users retain their reasonable expectation of privacy in their stored cell site location information. But the Third Circuit decided to avoid this question, and they said, we're not going to decide it. We're going to avoid deciding it by finding that judges have the discretion below to figure this out. What they did do, and this is part of the reason I think Jim is optimistic about the third-party rule being reconsidered by upper-level courts, is that they said that it's not necessarily true, as the government very vehemently argued, that just because your cell site location data is in the hands of your cell phone service provider, you have no reasonable expectation of privacy in it. If they had agreed with the government, that would have been an easy way to dispose of the case. So a broad third-party rule decision by the Third Circuit would have meant that the government won hands down. So it was a good thing for those of us who want a narrow vision of the third-party rule that the Third Circuit said, just because the cell phone service provider can get access to, or in fact stores your cell phone records, doesn't mean you have no privacy in them. But whether you have privacy in them or not depends on things we don't know, like, for example, how precise the information is. And that's why they needed a remand. Since then, interestingly, the Third Circuit sent back the case to the magistrate judge in Pennsylvania in Pittsburgh and said, figure this out. Figure out whether or not the information is so precise that it intrudes on the target's reasonable expectation of privacy and that a warrant is needed or not. And sort of unsurprising to me, but disappointing, the government dropped the case. And so I think this is something we've seen before, it's strategic behavior to avoid a bad decision. So we don't know what the facts would have shown if the magistrate judge had had a chance to find them. But since then, Judge Smith wrote another amazing decision in December of 2010, in which he said stored cell site location data is subject to the Fourth Amendment, and that's based on the nature of cell site location data, and it's a maybe a 50-page decision with a tremendous amount of information in it on the nature of cell site location data, drawing on congressional testimony, like all of Judge Smith's decisions, exhaustively researched. You know, you could tell from what he said before, he calls the providers, he calls lawyers, I know he talks to Al Ghadari, who represents providers, and reads everything, and he did this extremely exhaustively researched opinion in which he said cell site location data is just precise enough, we know, to implicate the Fourth Amendment, and that its acquisition is a search and a warrant's required, and that's how it is. And that was appealed by the government to the district court, who, as Judge Smith just said, issued a one-page decision saying, Judge Smith is right as a matter of Fourth Amendment law, not as a matter of judge's discretion, but Fourth Amendment law. And we are now in the process of appealing that, the same group of parties who, we are amici, we are not parties. Again, the targets have mostly not been identified. Maybe one of them has been identified, but most of them have not been identified. And so the amici have reassembled, and we have, I think, about 3 more weeks before we have to file our briefs in the Fifth Circuit. And so we'll let you know what happens. And then in the meantime, there was another very nice decision in the Eastern District of New York in which Judge, I cannot pronounce it, but it's Garufas is how it's spelled, and he issued a decision saying, you know, as a matter of normative analysis, access to cell site location information requires a warrant. It's a search under the Fourth Amendment. Meanwhile, at the same time, other cases have proceeded and said, I still like the third-party rule. If the provider's able to get your records, or it's their records, you have no privacy interest in them. How does Jones impact this? I think that Knotts is severely weakened after Jones. We haven't talked about Knotts, but Knotts is the decision from the 80s where the court said that the government doesn't need a warrant to use a beeper to track you on a public road for basically a single trip. And as I think Kevin said, the Supreme Court rejected the idea that just because your information's out in public, it's no longer private. So what I think the government is pulling back from that argument, and I think that although it's only explicitly mentioned in Justice Sotomayor's concurrence, the third-party rule has been weakened by Jones as well. Lastly, just my pitch again, which I mentioned a little in the primer, I think access to cell site location information is intrusive, continuous, indiscriminate, and hidden, just as is wiretapping, just as is silent video surveillance, and therefore it should be subject to the highest levels of protection and subject to the greatest level of judicial oversight, and I hope that that we go that direction, and I'm skeptical that Congress will go there on their own, so I'm very pleased that the judges are pushing them in that direction.
Thank you. Stephanie, do you want to take up the law enforcement banner?
Sure. So I was a federal prosecutor for about 15 years. I worked both in the field in the Southern District of Florida and the Miami U.S. Attorney's Office, used ECPA as sort of regular bread and butter statute in the course of investigating crimes, and then came up to Maine Justice, worked in the counterterrorism section, and then really shifted and went and worked for the House Judiciary Committee at the time when John Conyers was chairman of the House Judiciary Committee. And the digital due process effort that you heard about from Jim and others was being presented to Congress as a way to generate interest in ECPA reform and bring together companies and scholars and ECPA thinkers to guide Congress in the appropriate directions vis-a-vis reforming this statute that first came about in 1986. And in the course of working for House Judiciary Committee, I was permitted to develop 3 different ECPA-based hearings. One was a general introduction to the many complex and confusing ECPA issues that you've heard about today. The second dealt mostly with the stored communications content issues vis-a-vis the cloud that you heard about. Rick Salgado testified along with many others. And another one was based specifically on location data. And I have to say, both as a lawyer and as a staffer, That was the most difficult hearing to put together. Thank goodness Judge Smith agreed to be a witness and try and help bring some clarity, at least to what the confusion was. So why was this so, why is this such a confusing area? Why are these questions so hard for Congress from a policy level to discern the direction policy should take? The first, in my opinion, is that the law in this area is, quite frankly, a mess. Locating the proper standard for prospective cell site data, i.e., law enforcement's ability to access cell site data real time, is in some respects like the quest for the Holy Grail, the search for the fountain of youth, or, and the women in the audience will understand this, the hunt for a truly comfortable pair of high-heeled shoes. One is unlikely to find them. So what we have is a situation where even within the same district, very earnest magistrate judges like Judge Smith are interpreting the law to require different access standards for prospective data, and that uncertainty and differentiation between magistrate judges in the same districts has now even become, has been visited on historical cell site data. Judges must grapple to work with a law that predates essentially the state of location technology. We in 1986, those of you who are old enough to remember, cell phones were the size of small kitchen appliances. So Congress, you know, as forward-looking as it could be in 1986, obviously couldn't imagine the proliferation of what would happen with cell phones and other mobile devices. When you are left with that kind of instability, some will even call chaos in the law, it makes it very hard for all stakeholders involved, for judges to apply the law, for prosecutors and agents to know what the rules are so they don't have to grapple with judges to get the information they need to proceed in their investigations. For companies, those in the middle, who must comply with these orders that are coming out, but wonder, am I violating the law? And of course, generally, I think for privacy and just a fair justice system operating, if one judge allows access with one standard and another judge allows access with a lower standard, that doesn't seem good for a justice system. Susan mentioned Judge Gorenstein's decision, which is probably, and I'll use Judge Smith's words, the most cogent expression of the government's hybrid theory. The hybrid theory being the government saying, well, we can get prospective cell site data if we combine a 2703D order with a pen trap device. Judge Gorenstein literally looked at a map of cell towers in the Southern District of New York at that time. What that essentially means is, you know, fast forward even 6 months later, where because, let's say, the amount of data in an urban area like that increases, cell providers put up more cell towers, employ a technology called picocells, femtocells, or microcells, which are devices you can literally put on your house that will increase the ability of your phone not to drop calls, and their signal strength extends as far as your house. So as you walk down, let's say you walk down the street in a neighborhood and each house has a picocell on it, your phone will register connection with that picocell, and in theory then, it creates a little map of everywhere you're walking. So what that essentially means for the analysis of Judge Gorenstein's opinion is, well, my goodness, you need to look at a map of the deployment of cell towers and microcell technology every time you're trying to determine what the standard should be. That seems like a state of the law that none of us want to live with. So again, that made it very difficult to try and begin to guide Congress on what they should do. Secondly, with the tremendous work that the Digital Due Process Coalition did and coming up with principles, their proposed principle for a location standard was essentially, and you've heard Susan and Jim talk about it, an all probable cause standard, meaning that a probable cause Rule 41 like warrant would be needed for any type of cell phone collection of data, whether that's a single data point of historical data or 60 days worth of prospective data, real time. And while there are while I certainly understand those arguments, given my law enforcement background, the first thing that I thought was, well, that's law enforcement's not going to love that. That's going to kind of be a non-starter for them. They will argue that legitimate investigations might be foreclosed at the outset because, as Jim Dempsey talked about, law enforcement investigations proceed somewhat in building blocks. You have to acquire certain types of information that give you direction or about the investigation and it's the facts as they unfold, and that leads to the ability then to build to get to more intrusive standards like search warrants or wiretap orders. So at some point, law enforcement has to be able to acquire a base level of data, not at a probable cause standard, so that an investigation can increase. Imagine, for example, if you were asked to write a book report or a paper on Moby Dick, but you were only allowed to read the first line, "Call me Ishmael." It would be very difficult for you to summarize the plot, talk about who the characters are, if you weren't given more information. So that made it very challenging because you had essentially two of the major stakeholders, law enforcement and the privacy community, starting probably at positions that were going to be very difficult to meld together. The third thing that made it this particular hearing so difficult was that it's very difficult to get information about all the ways that law enforcement use location data and how much data is really being turned over. You saw Rick Salgado talk about statistics and how Google, and they should get kudos for this, are trying to bring those sorts of numbers in a more granular fashion that gives you more information, for example, about the types of investigations that various ECPA orders respond to. Congress needs that kind of information to determine, you know, which ways they should adjust standards to account for trends in technology, to potential uses and or abuses. Congress has an oversight role, and if they don't have access to that information, they're left a bit in the dark about what to do. So at the end of my time on House Judiciary Committee, I left the government, and I was still very frustrated about the lack of ability to come up with a standard that could serve the interests of all stakeholders. In other words, nobody would love it 100%, but everybody's position would be improved in some appreciable way compared to the current state of the law. So I joined forces with a gentleman that some of you may know named Chris Segoyan, who is a hardcore privacy advocate, who is not exactly friendly to law enforcement, and who's also a technologist and is very skilled at explaining deep technological issues to non-technical people like me. And what we decided is we'd write this law review article together and try and speed up the legislative process, mirror it in a way, through our own dialogical process, come up with a standard that would incorporate the interests and the equities of all the stakeholders. So I'll leave it at that for the moment.
Well, I mean, I feel like you have to bring us the punchline of what the standard is. I mean, this is sort of like not knowing about Moby Dick's about a whale.
Okay, sure. The standard. So we decided to look at historical information a little differently than prospective information. And so let me start with historical information. Law enforcement currently argues under its interpretation of ECPA, and there's been, you know, Susan explained the Third Circuit opinion, so I won't go into that, but for the most part, I shouldn't say for the most, in some courts, law enforcement is getting it with the D order, and that is specific and articulable facts that the information sought is relevant and material to an ongoing investigation. What my discussions with Chris and many others, he and I talked to a lot of people to get ideas, but in thinking about location data and how to better create privacy protections for location to data, we had to think about, well, what are instances where innocent people's data is being collected? Are there instances where law enforcement is just getting such a broad amount of information that isn't relevant, and what can we do about that in a standard while still giving law enforcement the ability to use the D order to collect information at the beginning stages of an investigation? And what we essentially came up with was the idea of scope, and that is that magistrate judges like Judge Smith should be required, or told by statute at least, that they should evaluate the scope of the government's request. And what do I mean by scope? Let's take, for example, a murder occurs on a street corner, and law enforcement doesn't have too many clues about who the murderer could have been. So they want to know every cell phone that was in the vicinity of the cell tower during the time the murder could have occurred. Well, if they don't have any information that somebody was stalking this particular corner for the past 2 weeks, then perhaps it would only be reasonable for law enforcement to request that kind of broad information for the time that the murder probably occurred, and to set out for a court why it is they're requesting 2 hours worth, 4 hours worth, whatever sorts of facts that they can present to prove that kind of scope. So we took the D order and we kept the current standard, but we added another element, and that is that specific and articulable facts showing that a reasonable and sufficient nexus exists between the alleged or suspected criminal activity and the scope of the location data requested. What we hoped is that magistrate judges could then engage very dynamically with the facts of a specific case and determine both the normal D standard, but also closely look at the scope to determine if it appropriately represented the needed amount to investigate the criminal activity. For prospective location data, we were able, that I said, to do a bit of a compromise in some way, thanks to a policy that Maine Justice was already taking. You heard Susan earlier in the day talk about a memo that was written for Maine Justice advising prosecutors in the field that they should only use a warrant and nothing lower for GPS or similarly precise data. One of the things that we, one of our witnesses, Matt Blaze, who's a professor at the University of Pennsylvania, testified about was that single cell tower data, i.e. my example of walking down the street and your phone connecting with the femtocell on the top of everybody's house or door, that can reveal information as precise as GPS. So if law enforcement is already being, quote, required, at least from a justice policy memo, to get it for GPS, there's really no good argument left from a technological perspective that you won't, in certain areas, run into precise data from just single cell tower information. But we had to deal with one other element for prospective data, and that is something that, two things actually. One I like to call the probable cause of what problem. And a professor named Oren Kerr first testified about this at one of our ECPA hearings. And that is, when we say probable cause, we normally think about Rule 41 standard, which is, for this, in this sort of situation, that the information requested will be, the information requested, there's probable cause, excuse me, to believe that the information requested will be evidence of a crime. In a lot of cases, location data will be evidence of a crime. It might pinpoint someone who was at the murder scene and with other investigation may be the murderer. It may refute an alibi. It may show that their travels are consistent with other overt acts that are alleged in an indictment in a conspiracy. But in some situations, the location information itself will not be evidence of a crime. If someone committed a crime in the past, their current location may not be evidence of a crime. Yet we may agree as a society that law enforcement should be able to locate where they are. That problem was illustrated by a magistrate judge recently in Maryland who would not even grant the government's Rule 41 warrant application probable cause because the government was merely trying to locate someone who had committed a crime. She didn't dispute that there was probable cause that the individual committed a crime. What she did dispute was that the location information itself was evidence of a crime. So you'd have to think about that as a matter of policy when designing even a probable cause standard. The second concern was that sometimes, especially with historical location data, you want to rule out someone from having committed a crime. If you have, again, we'll use the murder example again, if you have five murder suspects and only one of them is the murderer, if four of them, if you can request cell site data for, you know, a particular point in time showing that four of them were nowhere near the murder scene, that's not really evidence of a crime. That's evidence probably that someone didn't commit a crime. So you would want to be able to build in that kind of function. Again, thank goodness I've only been on the prosecution side, but having seen it, I would be very happy to have law enforcement rule me out of an investigation at the outset so that the rest of my life would not be continue to be scrutinized during the course of the investigation. And to close, while Chris and I spent a lot of time haggling over and ultimately writing about what we thought the standards should be, just as important as the standard, and Judge Smith's going to touch on this a bit, to really balance out the privacy protections, you needed Congress to do additional things, things that probably the courts can't do. You need minimization, which is when law enforcement, when they no longer need information for an investigation, purges it from the database. So in other words, there is no longer a record of where you were at a particular place or time. People need notice. You've heard other speakers talk about that today. And back to the statistics point, you need statistics so Congress can know what the trends are and can make policy decisions based on some hard, accurate data.
So it seems like you and Chris did as much as hard thinking as the Supreme Court did on the Jones case. You know, they seem to have agreed that your location is sensitive, but they couldn't decide on what the standard should be. I sort of tempted to get you in the room, all of you guys, with you and Chris could advise. Anyway, so, but Jones is such an incredible landmark in the location privacy debate that I thought it might be worth just getting everyone's opinion about how Jones has or hasn't changed the issues that you're looking at.
I'll take the first stab at that. As has been already talked about, I've written an opinion recently dealing with the historical cell site data issue and cell phone tracking and holding that was protected by the Fourth Amendment. And part of that decision was based on the D.C. Circuit opinion, Maynard. And again, that decision is now on appeal to the Fifth Circuit, so I'm going to resist the urge to cheerlead and just let that opinion speak for itself. The only thing I'll say, I think it does stand up pretty well in light of Jones. I'm not sure. In fact, I don't think I would have changed any of the legal analysis if I had to write it today. One thing about Jones that I would like to comment on is there was the last part of Justice Alito's concurrence suggesting that, well, the best solution to privacy concerns may be legislated. And this raises a question that I think it was also raised by the video clip that we just watched. If you remember our Mr. Nesbitt who refused to stand up. If Mr. Nesbitt cannot afford to stand up for himself, who does stand up for Mr. Nesbitt? I mean, assuming that not all the Nesbitts are criminals, some of them are hopefully many of them are law-abiding citizens. Who stands between ordinary citizens like Mr. Nesbitt and our increasingly surveillance-happy state? Now, Justice Alito's concurrence reflects an ongoing academic debate, and we've already touched on it earlier today, I think, which the question is often reframed as which branch of government, legislative or judicial, is best suited to rein in executive or oversee executive surveillance powers. But I think this debate has a whiff of artificiality about it. I mean, it's really a false choice, I think. It's almost like asking, you know, which part of an airplane is your favorite, the right wing or the left, or you know, whether it's better to pedal a bike with your right leg or your left, or to row a boat with one oar or two oars. I mean, after all, the legislative and judicial branches coexist. They're there. They operate side by side every day in every city and every county of this country. And more than that, they need each other to do the job. I mean, of enforcing rule of law in this country, and they cannot effectively do their job without the other. I think it's just rather idle to pretend that either branch is going to sit on the sidelines and twiddle their thumbs while watching the other play the game. So the proper answer to the question, I think, which branch, legislative or judicial, should oversee executive surveillance power is both of them. I mean, both of them have a role to play. Now, that's not to say that both branches have actually lived up to their responsibilities very well. I mean, if you can take a look at the legislative branch, the one that's most accountable to the people, now it's true, as Justice Alito says, Congress is well situated to gauge changing public attitudes, to draw detailed lines, and to balance privacy and public safety as it sees fit. But, you know, with all due respect, how often does it see fit? I mean, ECPA was passed in 1986. I mean, before the advent of smartphones and Google and even the World Wide Web, the basic architecture remains in place, but the edifice is really showing its age, and the need for major renovation has been known for a long time, especially with regard to this location issue. I mean, it was an issue back in 1994 when Congress passed CALEA. Now, I know numerous bills have been introduced to patch this hole in the roof of ECPA, and some are still pending now. But in the meantime, magistrate judges have issued hundreds of thousands of orders giving law enforcement access to location data with no congressional guidance about what the legal standard is. I mean, this gap in surveillance law has now persisted for 18 years. I mean, talk about a congressional oversight. look at the judicial branch, and more specifically the Supreme Court, which after all is the ultimate arbiter of the Constitution and our system. Has it done much better? Well, I hate to criticize my superiors, but the Supreme Court has decided a total of two cases involving ECPA in the quarter century since that statute was passed. And in the most recent of those cases, that was the City of Ontario versus Kwan case, the Supreme Court expressed the worry that maybe they were moving too fast. Justice Kennedy said, well, the judiciary risked error by elaborating too fully on Fourth Amendment implications of emerging technology before its role in society has become clear. Well, what was the emerging technology they were so hesitant to consider in Quan? Pagers. Alphanumeric pagers. I mean, I'd say that their role in society is pretty clear right now. Nobody has one. Of course, it's unfair to pin all the blame on the Supreme Court, because their selection pool of cases generally comes from the courts of appeal. And cases are scarce as hen's teeth at that level, too. And take our topic for today. So far, only one federal appellate court has ever considered what the proper legal standard for government to obtain cell phone tracking records from your phone company. And with all due respect to the advocates here, many of whom wrote briefs, I mean, that decision left open as many questions as it answered. Now, I don't know of any other area of the law where appellate guidance is so lacking. I mean, to give you some perspective, every year in the federal system, 15,000 employment discrimination cases are filed in federal court. And based on innumerable Supreme Court and circuit precedent, every trial court, every litigant knows what the plaintiff's burden of proof is in those cases. It's inconceivable that it would be otherwise, right? That many cases every year. Well, every year, twice that number, that is 30,000 electronic surveillance orders are issued by federal magistrate judges, by my count. I've had to do some digging to come up with that figure. And yet there's zero precedent really telling us what the government's burden of proof is. I mean, how is that conceivable? 30,000 a year? And since 1994, I mean, you do the numbers. And we don't have an agreement about what the burden of proof is. So, you know, that leaves it all to the magistrate judge. And, you know, as I say, it all rolls downhill. Unlike the Supreme Court, we don't have the luxury of picking and choosing the exact vehicle that we want to expound on gaps in the law. Nor do we have the option of retrospective adjudication, that is, waiting until a suppression motion is filed to evaluate the legality of a search that has already been conducted. I mean, when a federal agent walks into my chambers and asks me to sign an electronic surveillance order, there's nobody there but me to make sure that the Constitution is being followed. I mean, at that point, I'm the only backstop. Magistrate judges swear an oath to uphold the Constitution. If we sign a warrant and then our considered opinion violates the Fourth Amendment, then we violated that oath. And so when we conclude that certain types of surveillance orders have to be denied because they don't comply with the Constitution, then I think we owe it to the public and law enforcement to explain our reasons on the record. That way, our conclusions can be challenged and tested, and not only in the courts of appeal, but also in the court of public opinion. So, in short, I think magistrate judges should stand up, even though perhaps Congress and the Supreme Court have yet to do so. I think we owe that much to Mr. Nesbitt and the Nesbitts of the world. All
right. Thank you very much. And, Judge Smith says he doesn't want to be a cheerleader for his opinion or his work, but I am happy to be that person. His opinion is as amazing as you can imagine from listening to him. And I also want to commend to you his written law review articles. There's another one coming out soon, and hopefully we'll have one in our law review. And just to remind people that at some point down the road, many people who are attending this or who are speaking at this symposium will be writing articles in the Law Review Symposium issue, and I recommend that you read those. So Judge Smith raises so many important points, one of which is, this question of, is it Congress's job or is it the court's job to fix this problematic area of the law? And I absolutely agree that the answer is yes, and both. And yet it's clear that there are hindrances to both. And I don't think I need to talk about the problem with Congress, because we all know what's wrong with Congress. But I want to talk, I'm sure we all have different opinions about it, but I think we all have some sense of it. But in terms of what's wrong with the courts, I want to elaborate a little bit on my thoughts there, because I think One of the big problems, and I talked about it a little bit with our discussion this morning in the primer, I think the reasonable expectation of privacy test is just tough. And I think courts are not comfortable with it. And going back to Julia's question, I think that that's something that the Jones case shows me, the reasoning and also the oral argument. The justices kept saying, can you give us a test that we like? So I think it's, I've tried with my four-factor test to come up with some other ways to think about when it is that electronic surveillance requires really a meaningful judicial oversight. And I think that's the direction we need to go, is to figure out what it is about electronic surveillance that requires these meaningful protections that are so lacking now, that Judge Smith has been talking about, oversight by the judge, notice to the target, public transparency in the sense of reporting to Congress and the public, meaningful remedies, suppression remedy, et cetera. And I think that one thing that the Jones decision showed me is that the Supreme Court is there to recognize when there's an ick factor that we just have to take account of. I mean, there was just something so icky about the law enforcement putting GPS devices on our cars and tracking them. And I think that the Supreme Court adequately, you know, whatever the method used, understood that we as a society don't want to live that way, where for periods of time law enforcement can track our every movement without any evidence that we've been engaged in some kind of criminality. So I think the Supreme Court is there for us, and courts are there for us, which is one reason I'm optimistic that they will continue to figure it out. But I also am so grateful that we have judges like Judge Smith who say, you know what, I'm not just going to go the easy way here and say, you know, oh, it's the third party rule, that's easy, or let's just let Congress figure this out, because someday they will, and instead digs in and tries to do the hard work. So
I agree that there is a role both for the courts and for Congress, but let me address sort of what Congress should do post-Jones. And better? Thank you. At least in the area of cell site data and how law enforcement acquires that, both prospective and historical, I don't think Jones offered any clarity. I don't think we have any better rules for all of the stakeholders to follow. And we clearly know that the Supreme Court is concerned. So perhaps, you know, this will be another nudge to Congress that they have to really buckle down and work through more specific rules to give all of us guidance. I like to think about it sort of, if you like pastrami sandwiches and you go to a deli, you want your pastrami cut really, really thin. Congress is in a position now to try and draw some of the difficult lines that I think at times it's hard for courts to draw. The Fourth Amendment can be a very blunt tool. It can be a very, you know, large piece of meat versus the very fine cuts of meat that you might get in a good pastrami sandwich. So I think Congress has gotten another nudge, and this is super hopeful. This is not a forecast, but I think also Jones, if I were still at DOJ and I were tasked with giving guidance to the field about what they should do post-Jones, because when you're in the field, you just want to follow the rules. You want to know that when it's time to take your case to trial, that the evidence you've collected is admissible, mm-hmm. and that it's not going to be knocked out because you didn't follow a rule that a newly announced rule. So perhaps those thinking about this at the Justice Department will want to really engage with finding some sort of compromise for standards for location data that will improve the equities of individual privacy, law enforcement, and industry. And I at least when I was on the Hill, what industry said to me is, look, we just want clear rules. You, Congress, are in the best position to balance and draw the lines, but we need clear rules, especially in this area.
And this is clearly the best panel. We have pastrami sandwiches. We have Monty Python. I'm not even going to try to compete on that level. I want to open it up for questions.
My cell phone is turned off. Can it be tracked by a cell phone tower? Number two, my cell phone is turned on, but I'm not speaking on it. There's no conversation going on. Can it be tracked by a cell phone tower? Now I've called your number up and we're speaking. Can it be tracked by a cell phone tower?
So tracking can happen in second and third for sure.
And the first one, is it in airplane mode?
I don't know.
Then no, it's not. And so, yes, it can be tracked. And even if it's in airplane mode, it's still hard to block the signal, is my understanding. You have to put it in a Mylar bag. And even then, it's still hard to block the signal. Paul, do you want to add anything else to that?
Yeah, I mean, that's the bottom line. It's a radio. It's always on. And it's transmitting signals often when you think it's not. And that goes double for the smartphones, which are sending all sorts of different signals in different bands. I mean, I wouldn't put it past them that maybe when it's turned off, but if you're an important enough target, they might find ways to convince your phone to wake up a little bit. So,
I mean, the stuff I've read is that when law enforcement or other people have gotten a phone and want it to stop transmitting, it's actually difficult to get it to stop transmitting. You have to, put it somewhere and then isolate it, and so I mean that's sort of it's hard to get it to stop transmitting.
Yeah, better to leave it at home. Huh? Leave it at home if you're really worried. Next.
I just had a question about this issue of preciseness and how that's relevant to the level of protection you're entitled to. I really didn't follow that train. Is that something that all of you who are working in this area think is relevant?
Do you want me to do it?
Well, it comes down to a couple of Supreme Court decisions that basically deal with the issue of tracking Cairo and Kilo, they're two of the cases are Kilo. Basically, the Supreme Court says that if the device is able to reach into and reveal information about a constitutionally protected space, so your home or your office or whatever, then at that point, then the Fourth Amendment protections kick in. But if they only give generalized information where they can't pinpoint you to a particular home or house or office, say just a general neighborhood, that at least for purposes of those cases, that's not going to be enough to trigger the constitutional protection. So it's at least Supreme Court, the way the Supreme Court has drawn those lines, that's where the precision problem comes in.
So think of it this way. If the information disclosed by your cell phone record, location record, is, I was in Framhall, I could say, well, you don't have a right to know that without a search warrant. But if the information was, I was at USF, it's so much less precise that the government could say, well, the information that Freewald was at USF, so many people saw her at USF, or particularly if I was outside. They would say, she exposed that information to so many people. She has no privacy interest in being and not revealing that she was at USF. So the precision of the information can be tied to how private it is. I think Jones actually helps reduce the importance of precision, because in Jones, the government said, hey, we just followed Jones on public streets, and yet the Supreme Court still said, the Alito 4 plus Sotomayor said he still had a reasonable expectation of privacy.
I have one for Stephanie and Judge Smith, but I'll go with Judge Smith. I'll get you later, Stephanie.
I'm sure you will.
I'm curious if you can talk, to the extent you can talk, about what changes you've seen in terms of the applications you receive. Have you seen an impact of Jones, not in the beyond the bumper beeper like GPS device context? Have you seen a change in terms of ECPA applications? Are you seeing the prosecutors being more cautious? Because it seems like Jones could throw into question a whole lot of stuff.
It's an easy answer to that. I haven't been on criminal duty since Jones has come down.
Okay. Stephanie, question for you.
So I don't know the answer to that.
In talking to you and to Chris about your paper and the standard you proposed, one of the judgments you made was a political one. Is what is salable? We don't think that a warrant for Stored is salable. Has that opinion changed at all since we've seen the introduction of a bill in the House sponsored solely by Republicans that would support a warrant for Stored location, as well as a bipartisan bill in the Senate? Does that, added to Jones, do you think that changes the political calculus at all?
No, I don't. Number one, no sponsor on the Senate side, no sponsor of that bill is actually in the Judiciary Committee, which is the committee that would have to consider mark it up, as you know, and before it made its way to the floor. Kudos to the advocacy efforts on the House side, but at the end of the day, there are very strong, I think both Democratic and Republican members on the House Judiciary Committee, that would, you know, take up law enforcement's side on this. Law enforcement could make a very compelling argument that a probable cause standard, because you're talking about for even a single piece of historical data, that's what that standard is, would harm their ability to conduct legitimate investigations.
Jim had a question. Oh, sorry.
I can hand it on. I've talked too much today.
More questions?
Let me ask a really quick one. Okay. Then. I tweeted that, like Jim Dempsey's comment, it's so interesting that we don't know what to do with after Jones. It's a good thing, but we're not quite sure. And it occurs to me, one of the strange things is, like, Justice Sotomayor may be further to the left than all of the stated positions of all of the advocacy groups. So here I'm going to push you on this, right? I'm drunk with the power of Jones, which is every one of you talking about cell site location starts with the premise that given enough justification, the DOJ should have access to this information. Are we ever going to come to a time where we invent a technology that is so invasive that we come up with a new Fourth Amendment doctrine that says, no, thou shalt not have that information? So across the bay in Berkeley, they now have got scanners that can recreate the images in your brain to a pretty frightening degree. Should we ever, like, should the EFF now start advocating for the totally off-limit parts to the Fourth Amendment where you just don't get that information? Because you guys all have the premise that, yeah, sometimes you can find out where I am because I bought a phone. You know, how silly of me to buy a phone.
Let me just say real quick in response to that, that before the Wiretap Act passed, when there was there were debates in Congress, and I think the number is 60 senators took the position that wiretapping should be permitted never, not for law enforcement, not for national security, and another 20 said only for national security, and then 20 said for law enforcement too, and then somehow eventually it was allowed
and
for
in the UK,
law
as I understand, in the UK it's only for national
security. So, you know, I was telling Jim after his talk that I kind of wanted to cry when he was talking about what happened when the, you know, we had this bill that was so much better than anything anyone's talking about now in 2000, and those days seem long gone and irretrievable. So, you know, maybe the pendulum will swing and maybe Justice Sotomayor will take us there, and maybe I need a few more drinks to get there myself, but...
is that no wiretapping is constitutional.
I think we're out of time, unfortunately. I do believe there are several states that have put DNA privacy actually on that list, so. Sorry. Okay, thank you all.
Thank you. 15-minute break to our next and last, but not least, panel. Thank you.